Dear students, in the previous lesson, we did a comparative study of the heart of different animals. In this segment, we are going to understand of the human heart. So, first of all, as we all know that human heart is a four-chambered heart, right? So, there is left auricle, left ventricle, right auricle and right ventricle. We have already learned about this in the previous class. Now, when we are talking about human heart, this human heart is a conical hollow muscular organ. Okay? And this human heart is located in the mediastinum. Okay? And it fits into the cardiac notch. Now, what is the cardiac notch? This cardiac notch is a slight depression that is present on the left lung, right? So, in a simple language, you can say that human heart is located in the thoracic cavity behind the sternum and it is slightly tilted towards the left. So, you can write that also. So, it lies in the thoracic cavity behind the sternum slightly tilted towards the left. In between the lungs, right? So it is lies in the thoracic cavity in between the lungs, behind the sternum, and it is slightly tilted towards the left. Okay? Now, coming to the size of the heart. If you see the size of the heart, you will see it is just like the size of a tight fist, like this. If you tightly hold this hand, then it resembles the tight of the fist. Okay, now if you compare the heart of males and females, you will understand that in case of females, the size of the heart ranges from 230 to 280 grams. Okay, and in case of males, it is around 280 to 340 grams. Okay, so this we have understood. Now, next we have to understand that this whole heart is surrounded by a double membrane transparent structure, rather a double layered transparent membrane. Okay. And this double layer transparent membrane is known as pericardium. Okay, so let me rub this off. So the heart is surrounded by a double layered transparent membrane, which is known as pericardium. Okay? Now, this pericardium is further divided into outer and inner. Okay? Outer and inner. The outer pericardium is known as the fibrous pericardium. Okay, students, and the inner pericardium is known as serous pericardium. Okay, now this serous pericardium is further divided into outer and inner. The outer the serous is further classified into outer and inner. The outer one is the parietal and inner one is the visceral. Okay, now this serous is so, that means pericardium is further divided into the fibrous pericardium and serous pericardium. The serous pericardium is further divided into outer parietal and inner visceral. Okay, now coming to the walls of the heart. Now, the walls of the heart is divided into three layers. The first layer is known as the epicardium. Right? The second or the middle layer is known as the myocardium. Okay? And the third layer is the endocardium. Right? Now this epicardium is connected with the serous pericardium. Okay? And this epicardium is made up of connective tissue. Okay, next is the myocardium. The myocardium is the middle layer, as I have already told you, and this myocardium is made up of cardiac muscles. Okay, and amongst all the layers, myocardium is the thickest one. Okay, so because there is a presence of cardiac muscles here, so it is the thickest amongst all. Next one is the endocardium. This endocardium is made up of endothelial cells. Right, students? Now, as I have told you that serous is further classified into outer parietal and inner visceral. Now, in between these two layers, there is a fluid present, and this fluid is known as the pericardial fluid. Let me change my chalk. So, in between this and this layer, there is a fluid present which is known as the pericardial fluid. Okay? And this fluid is very, very important. Why? Because it acts as a shock absorber. Okay? Not only that, it provides smooth and lubricating surface for the smooth movement of the heart. Okay, so I can write it down here. Acts as a shock absorber first, and also provides smooth and lubricating surface for the movement of heart. Okay, so this is the function of the pericardial fluid, and this is very, very important from the question point of view. Okay, now coming to the internal structure of the heart. So unless I draw the diagram, you will not be able to understand it. So let me rub this off. Okay. So this I'm drawing the compartments. Yes, the ventricles are irregular in shape. I will tell you why. Okay. So as you can see, the heart is slightly tilted towards the left. From the beginning onwards, I have been telling you that its location is slightly tilted towards the left side. Okay, so the diagram also tells you the same thing, that it is tilted slightly towards the left side. Now, coming to the compartments, as you know that it has a four-chambered heart. So, since this one is the right side, so this one is the right auricle and this one is the left auricle. This is right ventricle and this is left ventricle. This you all know. Right. Now, I am not going to show all the layers of the outer layer of the heart because this will mess up the diagram. So, I have already explained you the layers of the heart in few minutes before. So, I am not going to mention that part. Okay. Now, this is the right auricle, left auricle, right ventricle and left ventricle that we all know. This one is the interauricular septum. That means this is dividing the two auricles. That is why it is known as interauricular septum. Okay. Now this one is the ventricular septum. Okay, this one is the interventricular septum, which is dividing the two ventricles. Okay, now when we are discussing about this, before we discuss about the internal structure of the heart, first you need to understand that on the interauricular septum you will find a slight depression like this. Okay. Since I don't have a color chalk, so I won't be able to mark it in a different color. Just look at this carefully, you will be able to understand that I have made a slight depression. Okay. Now, as I've said, on the interauricular septum, there is a depression. Fine. This depression is known as fossa ovales. Okay. Now this fossa ovales, these are the remains of the foramen of ovale. Okay. I will write it down on the board, whatever I am telling you. But before that, you just listen to what I am saying. Okay. This fossa ovales, these are the remains of the foramen of ovale. Okay, now this foramen of oval is actually a hole which is present during the embryonic conditions. So what happens, since this foramen of oval is a hole present on the on this part, okay, it is present during the embryonic conditions. So that means during the embryonic conditions, what happened during the embryonic condition, this part is having a hole, and that means there is mixing of blood taking place during the embryonic conditions. So as a result, what happens? So mixing of blood is taking place. So this, when after that embryo becomes an adult one, at the adult stage, what happens? This foramen of oval no longer remains, and it becomes closed. Okay, but it remains. This leaves behind a scar or a depression, and this scar or depression is known as the fossa ovalis. Let me repeat once more if you have not understood. But what I said is that this fossa ovalis, which you are seeing here as a depression on the interauricular septum, this is actually the remains of the foramen of ovale. Foramen of ovale. Okay? These are the remains of the foramen of ovale. Now, during embryonic conditions, what happened? Here, the foramen of ovale is actually a hole type which is present on the interauricular septum, and this facilitates the mixing of blood. Okay? It happens during the embryonic condition. Let me write it down. Embryonic condition. Okay? Now, at the adult stage, means at birth, what happens? Not adult stage, actually at birth what happens? This foramen of ovale no longer remains, it becomes closed. This foramen of ovale at birth, this becomes closed, and as a result, what happens? It leaves behind a scar or a depression, which you can see here on the interauricular septum. And that scar or depression is known as the fossa ovalis, right? Now, in many cases, though it is very rare, you will find that a child has a hole in the heart. Okay, that hole in the heart is this, what I was explaining right now. Okay, sometimes what happened, though it is very rare, in rare cases, the foramen of ovale, even at birth, it does not get closed. Okay. As a result, what happens, even at this hole remains, and that is what they talk about, the hole in the heart. Okay. But otherwise, in normal cases, at birth, this foramen of ovale will remain closed, leaving behind a scar, which is known as fossa ovalis. Okay. So, I hope I have made you understand. Now, after this, you need to understand that the deoxygenated blood, as you have learned in the previous classes, that the deoxygenated blood will be carried from all the different parts of the body, right? And it will be pumped into the right auricle. So, in case of human heart, we have understood that the deoxygenated blood is carried from the, if it is carried from the upper part of the body, then it is passing through the inferior vena cava. In other words, superior vena cava. In other words, what I am trying to say, the upper part of the body, upper part of the body carries the deoxygenated blood, and it pumps into the right auricle through the superior vena cava. Superior vena cava. Okay? And the lower part of the body brings blood and pumps into the right auricle through the inferior vena cava. From the word only you can understand. Inferior means the lower part, and superior means the upper part. Okay? So these two are the veins that are actually carrying the deoxygenated blood, and this deoxygenated blood is being carried from the upper part of the body and the lower part of the body, and they are pumped into the right auricle. Okay? Now, this, apart from this superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava, the deoxygenated blood which is present inside the heart, that means when the body, when the muscles of the heart utilizes the blood, okay, utilizes the oxygenated blood, that blood will turn into a deoxygenated one. So this deoxygenated blood has to be pumped into the right auricle as well. So this deoxygenated blood, which is being utilized by the muscles of the heart, will be pumped into the right auricle through a vessel which is present somewhere here. Okay, and this vessel is known as coronary sinus. So inferior vena cava is carrying the deoxygenated blood from the lower part of the body into the right auricle. Superior vena cava, what it is doing? The superior vena cava is taking the blood from the upper part of the body and pumping the deoxygenated blood into the right auricle. And what about the coronary sinus? Coronary sinus is also bringing the deoxygenated blood, but from the walls of the heart. So as I've said, the oxygenated blood is being utilized by the muscles, and this deoxygenated blood that forms will have to be pumped into the right auricle, right students? So this is done by the coronary sinus. It brings all the deoxygenated blood from the walls of the heart. Okay, now in the previous lesson we have understood about the functions of the valve, right? So here also we are going to talk about the valve. So those who have forgotten, let me repeat once more. In general, what we say, valve actually prevents any kind of backflow of the blood. Okay, so here you will see in the inferior vena cava as well as in the coronary sinus, there is valve present, and the reason is same, that is to prevent any kind of backflow of the blood. But what about the superior vena cava? Superior vena cava does not have any kind of valve. The reason behind this is its location. Let me explain. This superior vena cava, as you can see here, it is placed at an angle. Okay, so if it is placed at an angle, so when the auricles, right auricles, it contracts, okay, this superior vena cava automatically gets closed, right? So the superior vena cava, since it automatically gets closed, so there is no chance of any kind of backflow of the blood. So there is no valve present in the superior vena cava. But whereas in inferior vena cava and the coronary sinus, there is a chance of backflow of the blood. So here the valves are present. In case of inferior vena cava, the valve which is present is known as the Eustachian valve. You have to remember many things in the circulatory system, so please listen to it carefully. Acha. Next is coronary sinus. This coronary sinus is having a valve which is known as Thebatius valve. Okay, this is present in the this coronary sinus is having a Thebatius valve. Now, as you can understand, the deoxygenated blood is being carried through the superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and it is entering into the right auricle. Okay, from the right auricle, what happens? It is passing through the valve and it is pumped into the right ventricle. Right, students? Now, this ventricle, as it is being pumped into the right ventricle, there is a valve present here. Okay, at the right auriculoventricular junction. So you can write it like this. At the right auriculoventricular junction, there is a valve present. The reason for the valve being present in any of the you know, positions is same, that is preventing any kind of backflow of the blood. You just need to remember the location of the valve present and the name of the valve present. Otherwise, the function is same for all. Okay. So, here what happens, as I was telling you, the right auricular ventricular junction means this part, this one. Here, there is a valve present and this valve is a tricuspid valve. Okay. This is known as the tricuspid valve. Okay, why it is tricuspid valve? If you see, let me rub this off. If you see the tricuspid valve from the top, you will see somewhat like this structure. Like this. Okay, here you will see that there are three cusps or 1, 2, and 3. Three cusps present or three semicircular structures present. Okay. Since there are three semicircular structure or cusps present, so that is why it is known as tricuspid valve. And this tricuspid valve is present at the right auriculoventricular junction. Okay, now here what is happening? Here also you will see a valve present in between what? Left auricle and left ventricle. So that means at the left auriculoventricular junction, there is a valve present and this valve is known as the bicuspid valve. Okay, or in many textbooks you also find this as mitral valve. Same. Now why it is bicuspid valve? Let me rub this off. If you observe from the top, you will find this bicuspid valve remains like this. 1 and 2. Two cusps are present, okay, or two semilunar circles are present here. So that is why it is known as bicuspid valves. Okay, and both of these valves, as I have said you, I have told you that I have already said that these have the common function, that is preventing any kind of backflow of the valve, okay, backflow of the blood, okay. So, if the question comes, the difference between tricuspid and bicuspid valve, so you will be able to write down the difference. First and foremost, first difference is that in the tricuspid valve is located at the right auriculoventricular junction. In case of bicuspid valve, what is happening? It is present at the left auriculoventricular junction, right? There are three cusps present in case of tricuspid valve. In bicuspid valve, there is two cusps present. C-U-S-P-S. Two cusps present. Okay? Two cusps present. And what is happening here? This tricuspid valve is preventing the deoxygenated blood from being backflow to the right auricle. And here in this case, the bicuspid valve is preventing the deoxygenated blood, the oxygenated blood could become to backflow. It is preventing the backflow of the deoxygenated blood to occur. Okay, so today up till here we are going to do this. We are going to study. There are other structures of the heart as well. In the next lesson, we are going to study about the other parts of the heart. And we are also going to understand the blood circulation of the heart, how it is taking place. So, till then, thank you. Take care.